This
And
conference will now be recorded.
It will be available for viewing in the future if you'd like to go back and reference it. If you're having any trouble in terms of your device throughout the presentation, please use the chat feature. Sometimes if you have your cell phone on at the same time during this, the connectivity can be strong, weakened by that. So just be mindful of that. And if we have trouble hearing you when you have a question, again, use the chat feature. Please note that pets, children, and family members may inadvertently appear in the back of our screens. As you all know, we're all from home and it's nice to see everybody, but everybody's a part of our Manhattanville family. So work with us on that. I think that's all that I have. So just want a little bit of background. This is coming from an event idea that we had actually in person at the Met early that we had planned earlier in March and we had to cancel. So I am ever so grateful to our professors for making this available virtually. We're just very grateful to them. So it's my pleasure to welcome and introduce Randy Williams, Professor of Studio Art, and Jillian Hannum, Professor of Art History. Jillian? And you might need to unmute yourself. Jillian, we can't hear you. Jillian, I can't hear you. Can others hear Jillian?
No, can't hit Jillian.
You might need to hit your microphone on the screen.
I don't hear her either.
Jillian? And here's our tech person coming to help. We can't hear Jillian. Jillian? How did we lose her? She was, of course, it was fine in our test earlier.
Yeah, she was, we heard in the test.
Is her volume up?
Well, her mic wasn't on either.
Polly, maybe you can unmute everyone and then mute us and leave her on.
Is she frozen now?
Yeah, it's telling me she's not connected to the audio. She's connected
right now,
to the web.
Right now, she looks like she's frozen. So.
Yeah, because her hand is.
Jillian?
I think she's going to probably try to go off and come back on. Would be my thought.
There we go. Randy, do you want to talk a little bit what it's been like to teach this semester?
Talk about what it was like to teach this semester. Wow. you know, one of the things that was extremely helpful is that.
Can you hear me now?
Okay, we're good. Yes, Jillian is back.
All right, I just had to leave and rejoin. Something went wrong with the.
Okay.
We just don't see you now. Okay, let's see. There we go. And let's try to share the screen now. So I'm going to try to share the screen.
Well, there you are.
Yep. I think Polly may need to make me a presenter again.
Okay, hang on.
Yep. So anyway, while we're waiting for Polly to make me the presenter. The idea, we've done this twice before at the Met, and the idea for this, I don't know, goes back a couple of years when I was sort of thinking about the different ways that art historians and artists and art educators think about a work of art. And Randy and I were sort of chatting about that and got this idea of picking four paintings and doing, you know, sort of two different takes on each one. And so basically what this is about is sort of different ways of interacting with a painting. And so let me see if I can get my, I need my assistant one more time to get up my screen here. Can you all see the slides?
We see, yeah, we,
yes, okay.
Yep.
Yes.
Okay, this one?
Yeah.
The notes.
And if you, if you see a line at the top of the slides, you can make the, you know, what you see of the slides a little bit larger. And then I have a plus and minus to the right of my screen. And I think everybody has that where you can enlarge your view of the slides as well.
Okay, so I think we're good to go now. So as Polly said, we were originally gonna do this talk at the Met in late March. We would have only been able to have, I guess, 20 people or something with us. So this way we have a bigger group. Because March is Women's History Month, we selected paintings either by women or offering interesting insights about women. So you'll find kind of a women artist, woman as subject, kind of feminist theme a little bit running through this. And I picked the first two paintings, so I'll start the conversation about them and Randy will follow me. And then Randy picked the second two paintings, and so he'll lead off on those ones. So the first painting, perhaps, you know, the most fitting way to begin the theme of women is with one of the most well-known female artists, the 17th century Italian painter Artemisia Gentileschi. When I studied art history as an undergraduate in the 1970s, there was not a single woman artist included in Janssen's History of Art, which was the textbook for the survey courses. I think 1980 was the first edition of Janssen that had women artists in it. Gardner's Art Through the Ages was a bit sooner, but Artemisia Gentileschi was one of the first female artists to appear in the textbooks. As with so many female artists from the 15th, 16th, 17th, and even 18th centuries, Artemisia was the daughter of an artist, Orazio Gentileschi, and he trained her in Rome where they lived. Orazio was an early follower of Caravaggio. Probably the most well-known story about Artemisia is that she was raped in 1611 by a fellow artist, a man named Agostino Tassi, who had been hired by her father to help her with perspective. Orazio sued on behalf of his daughter. There was a long trial, and although Tassi had been convicted as a rapist earlier and had even served time in prison, Artemisia was really subjected to humiliating treatment during the trial. She was tortured. She had thumbscrews and cords around her wrist to determine whether she was telling the truth or not. So this was really a humiliating situation. The court transcripts are missing the last few pages that detail what the verdict was, but it is known that Tassi spent 8 months in prison after the trial, but then was pardoned and released. Orazio filed cases against six of the defense's witnesses because Agostino Tassi had brought in witnesses who claimed that Artemisia was a prostitute and a whore. After this awful situation, Artemisia married a minor artist and moved to Florence in 1612. The marriage only lasted a couple of years, was probably arranged by her father, again, to restore her reputation. But in later years, she worked in Rome, Venice, Naples, and then briefly in 1634 in London. And she came to be a very widely respected artist. She was the first female member of the Accademia del Disegno in Florence in 1616. She also had connections to the court of Cosimo II de' Medici. Just looking at a detail of this, the subject of the painting is an Old Testament subject. It's from the Book of Esther. The Persian king Ahasuerus, better known as Xerxes I, had made the beautiful Esther his wife after his previous wife, Vashti, had offended him. However, it seems that the king didn't realize that Esther was Jewish. And when a decree went out that all Jews in the Persian Empire were to be massacred, Esther took steps that were quite bold at the time. She went into the king without being summoned, which, you know, even for a wife at that time was very, very bold. In fact, could have been punished by death. And she pleaded with the king for her people. The moment that Artemisia shows us is Esther fainting in fear as she appears before the king, who ultimately forgives her boldness and grants her request. Artemisia's painting seems to have been influenced by a depiction of the same subject by the Venetian painter Paolo Veronese, a painting that is now at the Louvre, but that would have been in Venice when Artemisia was there between 1626 and 1630. And it's thought that the Metz painting, the one that we're thinking about, might have been executed towards the end of this period, around 1630. Esther was a favorite subject of Veronese, and the Jewish holiday of Purim, which this year was celebrated in March, on March 9th and 10th, actually commemorates this event, which was another reason that I chose this one for what was to be a March event. Artemisia Gentileschi was the first female painter to really focus on history themes rather than on painting portraits. And she went on to become particularly well known for depictions of strong and powerful women from the Bible. Probably her best known theme is the theme of Judith and Holofernes from the apocryphal Book of Judith. X-rays of the Met painting show a depiction in the lower right corner. You see here the X-ray of the lower right corner that at one time showed an African page holding a dog. That was painted out. We don't really know why, but that detail also suggests the influence of Veronese, who often included lots of additional figures in his paintings. Stylistically, this is a textbook example of the Baroque style. It's very theatrical, shows the moment of highest emotion. Strong diagonal lines compose the form, giving a lot of movement. The dramatic lighting is again an influence of Caravaggio. It's like a spotlight. Again, her father and she herself were both followers of Caravaggio. One last kind of interesting tidbit before I pass to Randy. Scholars in recent years have noted that the clothing, and especially the clothing of the king, resembles theatrical dress of that period, the 17th century, in Italy. In other words, it's not, you know, the kind of clothing that would have been worn in biblical times. And a current theory is that this may have been sort of a veiled parody of male rulers, suggesting the superiority of women. Feminist art historians have really latched on to Artemisia Gentileschi. And we do know that while she was in Venice for that period of 3 to 4 years, Artemisia was part of a literary and intellectual circle, one of whose members, another woman, wrote a treatise that was entitled, I'll translate, The Nobility and Excellence of Women and the defects and vices of men. So no wonder Artemisia was one of the first artists to be embraced by feminist scholars. Randy?
Okay. You know, one of the things that I often think about when I'm looking at art is that I approach it from certainly a different point of view than an art historian. My first way of thinking about art is approaching it from a back door and not thinking about the historical perspective. I think about it as an artist, and I think about it as one who has worked in the museum for over 45 years, and then I think about it as someone who teaches art. So I'm going to approach this from a very different point of view. When I walk into a museum, the first thing that I do is I ask my viewers not to look at labels. And I look around very quickly to make sure that there are no curators that would yell at me about this. But I want them to see what they could bring to the work of art from their own experiences. And a lot of times what people tend to think about is that they don't know that much about art. And they don't know that much about looking at art. But in fact, they are incorrect, because the relationship between looking at art and experiencing things from life are one and the same. Now, painting to me is incredibly fascinating. I always think about it as the alchemists who actually figured out the way in which to turn metal into gold. Because they have taken paint and they've turned it into matter and into flesh and into objects. And Picasso once stated that art is alive, what teaches us how to see. And what we need to do when we think about works of art is to think about our own experiences, the things that we experience when we have our daily encounters. But there are two things that I want to focus on. One is the principles of design. Because a lot of times we think that looking at art is only about its subject matter, but it's how that story is being told that makes art great. And so I want to just do a couple of things here. And one is, I'm getting some feedback here. Can everyone hear me okay?
No.
You're getting some feedback, Randy.
Yeah, I noticed that I'm getting feedback. What about now?
Good.
Okay, I don't know where that came from, but I apologize.
Here comes again.
I don't know how to.
I think someone may have come in by phone. So if you joined us by phone, if you could mute your phone, we would be grateful, because we're hearing noises in the background. Thank you. It looks like it's muted now.
Okay, so maybe. Hopefully. So the two things that I want to focus on is the idea that form and content work hand in hand. And when I approach works of art, what I'm trying to do is help for viewers to understand the importance of the form. I'm getting that feedback again. So if we look at the figure on the right, we see that wonderful diagonal. And if we look at the figure at Esther on our left, we get a slight diagonal. And so in between the two figures, we have this incredible space. But what becomes so dynamic is the placement of light. And it becomes so incredibly detailed, like the light that's on both her hands. One hand is coming out of darkness into light, and then the hand that is lowered is lit completely. And if you go to the face, you see the same thing is true. The left side of the face is in this beautiful flush of light, and the right side is obscured with this darker area. If you look at the two women that are accompanying her, one is in complete profile and the other is in a slight three-quarter view, not completely frontal. If you look at the placement of pigment, it is so incredibly placed that it's like a musician playing or a composer composing a piece of music. The blue that's around the waist becomes picked up in that same blue that's at the shoulder and behind her. The blue is then saturated and muted. So if you look at the lacing that's on the bottom of her dress, you begin to notice that you have this white-blue tint. Looking at the figure to the left, that wonderful sepia tone is to highlight that high yellow ochre that appears to give us this goldish color that's in the dress of Esther. And if you look at even the details of the figure that is poised to move out of the chair at this very decisive moment, how one foot is on the edge of its platform. And if you look at the foot that's in the back, you notice that the heel is slightly off the ground. And it's those details that I find so interesting when I look, when I'm looking at works of art. I find that I could stand in front of a single painting for hours and come back to them again and again, because it's those details that the artist has employed that helps us to understand the relationship between what is real and what is painterly. I'm often thinking about art as being a metaphor for this life process. People often think, I need to know the history to know the art. And what we do in museums is that we have people understand art from the point of view of their own history. And then we broaden that to help them understand the historical perspective of the painting. So that's the way one would approach this from the point of view of a museum educator, thinking about the object in and of itself. Okay.
Okay, ready?
Mm-hmm. Go to next.
All right. So moving ahead about 150 years, we have another painting of a woman by a woman. This is Elizabeth Louise Vigée Le Brun's Comtesse de la Chapre from 1789. So this was painted in the year of the French Revolution, and it was painted by Queen Marie Antoinette's favorite painter. Elizabeth Vigée Le Brun was born in 1755, and she was probably the most important woman painter of 18th century France. In fact, the Met mounted a major exhibition of her work that some of you might have seen in 2016, which was just a breathtaking exhibit of an artist who just has a wonderful facility with paint. Like Artemisia, Vigée Le Brun was also the daughter of an artist. Her father, Louis Vigée, was also a portraitist. He, like Orazio Gentileschi, was also her first teacher. And at the age of 19, she entered the Academy of St. Luke in Paris. Elizabeth married an influential art dealer, J.B.P. Le Brun, in 1776. And she received her first commission from Marie Antoinette in 1779, painting at that time what would be the first of more than 20 portraits of Queen Marie Antoinette. Elizabeth was named to the French Royal Academy in 1883, which was quite rare for a woman. I think the French Royal Academy only took four women members. And it was her relationship with the queen that brought her this honor. The subject of this particular painting is a member of the French aristocracy. The Comtesse was the daughter of Louis XV's premier valet de chambre, which was his first valet of the chamber, a very close servant to King Louis XV, who became a very rich man. She married a much older gentleman, the Comte de Nanquet, who was a lieutenant general in the army. And like the artist who painted her portrait, obviously she was a loyalist to the monarchy, and she fled France during the French Revolution. This painting was done in the months just prior to the artist's departure from France, which was in October of 1789. In the years after the French Revolution, Elizabeth Vigée-Lebrun lived abroad. She lived in Rome, in Naples, in Vienna, Berlin, St. Petersburg, and Moscow. She came back to Paris briefly in 1801 and then left again for London and Switzerland, finally returning to Paris in 1810 and remaining in France then until her death in 1842. She was a very, very prolific painter with over 600 works to her name. And she wrote a memoir, an autobiography, which was published between 1835 and 1837, not too long before her death. That biography, autobiography, was widely translated, and its English title is The Memoirs of Madame Vigée-Lebrun. If we look at a detail or a close-up, we can really see that her style here is a transitional one. She started out her career working in the Rococo style of the Ancien Régime, the very fussy decorative style that we associate with the old guard in France. But as she moved closer and closer to the period of the French Revolution, her style becomes more sober. And she's influenced by the beginnings of neoclassicism. In fact, she knew Jacques-Louis David and consulted with him about one of her paintings of Marie Antoinette. It was in the years just prior to the revolution that she did this painting, as I mentioned. And so we see the subject here wearing a fashionable style of the day that Marie Antoinette had actually popularized, a very simple white muslin dress. It's very freshly painted. If you look at the face, if you look at the hair, the wispy treatment of the hair, the gauzy treatment of the dress, we can really see that this artist was a master of technique. It's an informal portrait, something that we do associate with the Rococo style, but also in this case, something that may have come from the artist having looked at English portraits by artists like Romney and Rayburn and others, this very informal, you know, capturing a glance of the person, feeling very momentary. We don't know a lot about the subject here. She looks up at us as though we've disturbed her while she was reading. She looks at us very directly, very intelligently. Really, all we know about the Comtesse was that she was divorced from her first husband in 1793 and later married a minor noble, the Marquis de Jaucourt. This painting came down through her second husband's family. Her only child, a son that she had had with the Comte, had died at a young age. And it was purchased by an American in the early 20th century, eventually making its way to the Met as a gift of Jesse Woolworth Donahue in 1954. Randy?
Yes. Again, I want to go back to the idea of content and form. And as photographers would refer to this as that very decisive moment. And Jillian mentioned it seems as if the Comtesse has been disturbed by someone walking in and she is looking up. The book is slightly opened. That finger is marking her page. But what interests me as an artist is the idea of pigment onto a surface. Now, when we talk about facade, I'm going to talk about this a little bit more. But one of the things that I look at when I'm looking at a work of art are those principles of design and those elements of art. And these are the things that we generally saw teaching youngsters at a very early age. The idea of balance, the idea of emphasis, movement, repetition, proportion, and we know how integral that is when we look at the human body and the human form. We can feel through the cloth the physical anatomy of the figure. The idea of rhythm, and rhythm is not only determined through the repetition of things, but also with the paintbrush itself, variety and unity. And then we have these basic forms that we think of, line, shape, color, form, texture, and these things all go into this magical mystery of making a work of art. We look at that wonderful circular hat that's on the head and how it begins to frame the face in a circle and how it accents the rectangle of the painting itself and that wonderful couch that she's sitting on with the pillow, with that diagonal. And if we look at that wonderful green that is highlighted in the back of the couch, we see that amber, goldish arm being repeated in the brim of the hat as well as the lining of the pillow. If we begin to look at the modulation of color in the dress, we think at first it's white, but we know that white is modulated with shades of lights and darks based on how the light hits certain portions of the contour. And we can sense that and see that here. And then we go to the face. And as Jillian had mentioned, when I look at the hair, I am so convinced that this is so textural and so real. We think about the idea of symmetry. And it's interesting because artists, when they begin to do their studies, the first thing that they recognize and they realize is that the face is not symmetrical. And if we, in fact, paint a face that is symmetrical, it begins to seem somewhat artificial. So when you look at the eyes, and you look at the nose and the mouth, what you begin to see is someone who is fixated on giving us an accurate depiction of what she is perceiving. And in doing so, we begin to register not just a painting, but there's a person that's in that work of art. One of the things that we often do with students, and we do it with young students, but it works with everyone, is to confront a work of art, just by ourselves. And the best way to look at art is not with a group in a museum and not with families and friends, but to go on your own, go by yourself and stand in front of the work of art and see what type of conversation you could have with this person. What I'm realizing, and I said this very early on before we started, I haven't been in a museum in 3 months. I haven't looked at art in 3 months. The only thing that I've been doing is teaching and making my own art. It's such a wonderful opportunity, even in this digital presentation, just to look at this face and get a sense about its humanity. And you think about the time period in which it was made, and you think about the relevance of this experience now, and you begin to see how art becomes so incredibly important and how it connects us to both this moment here as well as the past. Okay. I get to start. And, I have to thank Jillian because every time I do this, I get the benefit of her research and to read the things that she put together. And I've always been fascinated by Mary Cassatt. And my fascination with Mary Cassatt starts with my fascination with my mother and this piece in particular. My mother was a seamstress. And what I remember of her more than anything else was her always working on sewing and being in a position where it felt as if we needed to be quiet because it seemed like such a moment of peace and solitaire. So when I decided on this talk, this piece came to my mind immediately. And what I'm so engaged with this work, or how I'm so engaged in this work, is because of its relationship to the Impressionists, but also how this work becomes such a contemporary piece. When I talked about the idea of balance and emphasis and movement and repetition and variety, all of those things we have in this work of art. When we think about the colors that you have in the dress, and I'll get back to that in a moment. But the first thing that I do when I think about a work of art is I try to envision what is not there. and what's not there when the artist begins. And what it's difficult for people to understand if they're not an artist is that, and Cezanne said this better than anyone else. Cezanne stated that when you begin a work of art, you have to work the piece as if everything is there. And that makes sense, because when you look at your subject, when you look at a landscape, everything is there. And the Impressionists in general wanted us to respond to that. And Cassatt, working with the Impressionists, and in particular Degas, understood that implicitly. So you start with nothing, and the somethingness of your work of art is outside of you. And your job as an artist is to take that object that's outside and place it inside so that you create this parallel universe. And so the first image that I've sketched out here is simply a frame. The second image is how one might break the frame down. And you see these three smaller rectangles up top and this longer rectangle that's on the bottom. And this could be even complicated even more. But when artists are working and thinking and processing visual information, they begin to deconstruct the experience as they see it in nature or in a model, and they reconstruct it on the page or on a canvas. And so the third image here, you have an image where the figure begins to come into focus. You have the flowers in the vase. You have the young girl on her mother. You have the mother who's now outlined, and then you have the background. The other thing that becomes so relevant for people to understand is that when you think about your background, it is equally as important as your foreground. And this is one of the most difficult things to teach to young artists. I've had so many young artists will say that I want to design comic books. And they work forever on figures and forget that these people live in an environment. Well, if you look at the background here, and if you can envision removing the vase with the flower, removing the mother song and removing the girl, you still have this incredibly impressionistic background. But then if you begin to try and match the colors that you have in the background with the colors that you have in the dress of the mother, you begin to see that those colors are in fact complementary. And if you look at the furthest vista of the background, where you have those same grays, and look at the bars of the window, you begin to see the relationship between those two things as well. You can make this incredible leap of looking at the composition of a Mary Cassatt and thinking about the composition of a Piet Mondrian, because that's how intricate her compositions are. One of the things that I've learned just recently, and again, I thank Jillian for this, is that Mary Cassatt was an artist indeed, but she also was someone who loved art, who loved experiencing art at a very early age. And one of the things that I identify with as an artist myself is how much I love looking at art and learning from art and making that a life lesson. The other thing that is so wonderful about her work, and I'm sure Jillian will talk a little bit about this, is her relationship with her subject matter. And before I understood anything about her and her life, as I mentioned earlier, I identified with this woman so intently because of my relationship with my mother. It just reads of family, where both of these figures are so remarkably comfortable. And one of the things that is so important about looking at Cassatt's work, and this is also true of Degas, is that you begin to understand that the idea of form is matched with the idea of content. That this is an Impressionist painting. It reads as an Impressionist painting. And yet, in no way detracts from the relationship between the mother and the daughter and those wonderful flowers and the background and the environment that they're in. Jillian?
Okay, I'll go back to the full view here. I was thrilled when Randy picked this painting. It's one of my very favorites. I can just spend hours looking just at the fabric that's on the mother's lap, and the layers and the colors there are just so lovely. A little bit of background about Mary Cassatt. Unlike the previous two artists, Mary Cassatt was not the daughter of a painter. Her father was actually a wealthy Pennsylvania financier and land speculator, and her brother went on to become the president of the Pennsylvania Railroad. So she came from a family of great financial means. She was born in Allegheny City, Pennsylvania, which is now part of Pittsburgh, in 1844, but she moved to Philadelphia with her family when she was about six. And she was initially trained in the American Realist tradition at the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts. She was a student there between 1861 and 1865, starting her studies there the same year that Thomas Eakins did. They were actually also born in the same year. She left for Europe in 1866 and studied in Europe with Jean-Léon Gérôme, who was also a teacher of Eakins, beginning in 1866. And she also studied for a time with Thomas Couture, who was the teacher of Edouard Manet. She was quite successful in Paris. She had work accepted in the prestigious Paris Salon in 1868, and she showed in four more salons after that. Those were the official government-sponsored art shows. She became friendly, as Randy mentioned, with Edgar Degas, who was also from a banking family and had grown up wealthy, although the family lost most of their money in the Franco-Prussian War. But it was really Degas who convinced her to show with the Impressionists. Degas became very disenchanted with the Salon and was one of the prime movers behind the group shows of the Impressionists. And Cassatt participated in 1879, 1880, 1881, and 1886. So four of the eight Impressionist group shows she participated in. Hence, you know, we think of her as a member of the Impressionist circle. Like Degas and the Impressionists, she was influenced by Japanese woodblock prints with their strong colors and their intimate subject matter. And she actually made a series of Japanese-inspired prints. Hers are color etchings, not woodblocks, but in 1891, a wonderful set of prints. Perhaps she was never a pure impressionist in the mode of Monet. She never completely lost her interest in forms or her interest in love of drawing. We can see the figures here have a certain firmness to them, but she certainly embraced the flat forms, the bold colors, the painterly brushwork, the momentary quality. You can see the high horizon line here, typical of the Impressionists and influenced by Japanese prints. The higher the horizon line, the flatter the form appears as it's pushed up against the picture plane. Cassatt is particularly known for her intimate depictions of women and especially women and children. Perhaps that's somewhat ironic, as she never married and had no children of her own. But her first subjects were her family and their immediate circle of friends. Although in this particular painting, we actually have two completely unrelated paid models who were posing for her, which I think makes the intimacy between them perhaps all the more remarkable. By the time she did this work in 1900, she was beginning to go blind. Ironically, her friend Degas also suffered in later life from vision problems, as did Monet. This particular painting was purchased in 1901 from the dealer Durand Ruel by Mr. and Mrs. Henry O. Havemeyer, whose collection forms the core of the Met's body of Impressionist works. Louisine Havemeyer, who was Henry Havemeyer's second wife and the niece of his first wife, was actually a very dear friend of Mary Cassatt. And Cassatt had a huge impact on American taste by encouraging the Havemeyers to purchase some of the best Impressionist painting available at the turn of the 20th century. Louisine and Mary met in Paris in 1874 when Louisine was 19 and Cassatt was 30. And Louisine wrote a memoir titled 16 to 60, Memoirs of a Collector, which gives very interesting insight into how she and Henry built up their remarkable collection. Mary Cassatt gave up painting around 1914 due to her loss of vision and other health complications, and she died at her chateau outside Paris in 1926, and Louisine died in New York in 1929. So an interesting friendship that had a huge impact on American art.
And so we move to The Last Moments of John Brown by Thomas Hovingdon. And when we were designing this talk, I was thinking that I should have two female artists. And as I thought about it more, I then thought about the idea of subject matter. And as a male, having a point of view of how one can have insights into a female perspective. Now, this painting, which is at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, as all of our paintings, is one that I encountered when I first started working at the Met. And when I first started working at the Metropolitan Museum of Art, one of the more difficult galleries for me to work in was the American Wing. And I couldn't quite figure out why, but in more instances than not, it was one in which I felt I was not present in any subjects. And I took for granted that that would be the case in the European galleries, but not in the American galleries. And so very early on, I started going through the museum's collection, looking specifically for images depicting people of color. And there are some wonderful images in the American Wing. And sometimes you really have to search to find them. Obviously, you have Winslow Homer, Waterman Wood. So there are these wonderful images. But the one that I got kind of addicted to looking at was this painting by John Brown, or this painting of John Brown, His Last Moments. And for historical reasons, of course, and that made perfect sense. But also, I noticed in this painting these remarkable scenarios, these tableaus that were happening. And I want to spend some time talking about them because I think that they are incredibly important. And they're important even as we think about this current time period, as we think about these monuments that are being questioned and torn down and wanting to be re-erected. The history of John Brown is one which is quite interesting. He's an abolitionist, and I'm not going to go into that history because I think most of us are aware of it. But when we look at the work of art, and if you didn't know the title, it might be difficult without really looking at the painting very carefully to understand its true narrative. To the left of the painting, you have a soldier with his gun and a bayonet, and it does this wonderful diagonal frame. And you have this black figure who's being slightly pushed out of the frame. And this is just wonderful gesture. And that sergeant with that red stripe on his shoulder, which is now picked up in the pants, and that stripe jumps up to a second figure, then all the way over to the figure that I'm most interested in, and that is the woman holding the child and hoisting this child up to John Brown. And we see that he is almost presidential, and that this child is embracing this heroic figure. Now, not everyone thought that John Brown was a heroic figure. In fact, Lincoln thought that he was a little peculiar. Frederick Douglass was greatly concerned about his ambitions and what he was looking to do. But people after John Brown's attack at Harper's Ferry saw him as a Moses. And in many instances, he's perceived in that way. You see the figure to the left with the proclamation announcing the results of the trial. And then if we go to the next slide, we see a really interesting kind of scenario that's happening here. The woman that is lifting up the child to John Brown is accompanied in this drawing book of a young boy. That's to the right. Can we go back to the first slide of John Brown, Jillian? Now, if you look at the image here in the actual painting, that is not a boy, but that is a little girl. And this is probably, and I apologize, I should have tried to get a detail of this. For me, the single most important instance in this painting, because this young girl is with this black woman, and everyone around this woman, with the exception of the soldiers, are black. And the same thing is true on the opposite side. Now you have the delegation that's walking down the stairs and they're white, the soldiers are white, but everybody else, they're black. And this is an event. They're pushing through. They want to see what's happening here. And yet we have this young white girl who's holding on to the skirt of this black woman, and her head is in a similar position as that of all of the black figures. And whenever I see this painting, when I first saw it, I thought to myself, why would Huffington put that young white girl in that painting? And it makes perfect sense, because more than likely, this is a person who takes care of that young girl. And when I think about that, I think about the relationship between John Brown and Frederick Douglass. And if you ever read the narrations of Frederick Douglass, one of the things that he talks about early on in his narration is his relationship with his mistress who taught him how to read, and teaching a slave how to read was unlawful. And he felt a closeness to her, and he also perceived her as being a slave to conventions as well as himself. And I think about this image that Huffington has used with the relationship between that young white girl and the black woman hoisting the child, and just try to envision the type of relationships that actually occurred when people were enslaved. And there must have been some authentic relationships that people had. And I think that Huffington is trying to introduce this into this work of art. And that relationship between a mother who can be a mother of a universal mother of white children, her own black children, and probably love those kids as much as they love their own, because nurturing is nurturing. And I think that Huffington has magically infused this painting with one of those moments that people, when they look at it, they can so often miss this very decisive, very important moment. Lifting the kid, absolutely. Walking down the stairs, his last moment, absolutely. Everybody rushing in to see this famous figure who put his life, his children's life, on the line to free slaves. And yet we have that very wonderful moment that could sometimes be overlooked. And sometimes that wonderful moment, those relationships that happen between people, are often overlooked and neglected even during this time period. Can we go to the next image? And the next. And so this is the full comic book. And when someone actually gave this to me years ago, and they gave it to me not knowing that the figure had been taken out. And it was a whole collection of images that one would color in. And I just thought that it was such a criminal act to take that young girl out and put this figure in, and whoever did it, and I have no idea, turned the figure into a young black man, completely missing the point of Huffington's work of art, which I thought was so incredibly interesting. And if we could go to and I also thought about a work of another artist who I admire greatly, and relationship between Huffington's John Brown and John Brown going to his hanging. And this is by Horace Pippin. And Horace Pippin, a Philadelphia artist, self-trained. But at the same time, when we look at this piece, we could identify John Brown because he has ropes around him. We see this crowd of folks that are surrounding him. We see these two wonderful white horses. And if we talk about composition here, again, it becomes interesting because if you look to the left, you see the white fence, you see the white horses. If you look in the crowd, you pick up white again. And here's an artist who, for all intentions, he was self-taught. But even with that in mind, you still begin to make this collective view of the world around you and make these very intricate decisions as to how you're going to compose a work of art. But what I find so meaningful in this work of art is to the extreme left on the bottom, once again, you find a female figure. And each time I've read about this painting, it changed from time to time, but it is thought that perhaps this was the grandmother of Horace Pippin, who might have had some firsthand knowledge of this event. And so I thought that those two relationships may make an interesting comparison. Okay, Jillian?
Okay, so I'll just wrap up with a little bit of information. Thomas Huffington was actually Irish-born, an Irish-born American painter, probably less well-known to you than the other artists we've looked at today. Obviously, the subject matter, the abolitionist John Brown being led to his execution, is fairly well known. The event took place on December 2nd, 1859, following Brown's raid on the Federal Armory at Harper's Ferry in an effort to get guns and ammunition to support a slave uprising. As we all know, the raid failed. He was arrested and jailed in what was then Charlestown, Virginia. Today it's in West Virginia. And he was tried for treason against the Commonwealth of Virginia and sentenced to hang. This was such a timely choice of painting, I think, in many ways. Among other things, the fact that this occurred in a year leading up to a presidential election. And even among Northern abolitionists, as Randy indicated, opinion about, you know, Brown's tactics was divided. Some saw him as a martyr and a leader. Others saw him as a terrorist. He certainly became the subject of poems, of legends, of songs. During the Civil War, Union soldiers marched south singing, "John Brown's body lies a moldering in the grave, but his soul goes marching on," a tune that probably many of us know. Mm-hmm. It seems to have originated with the Massachusetts 12th Regiment in 1861. A lot of different versions of it exist, and it in turn formed the basis for Julia Ward Howe's later Battle Hymn of the Republic. Brown's an interesting figure, and I won't take the time to talk about him. You know, I really only knew him, you know, around the history of Harper's Ferry event, but his life is really fascinating. Mm-hmm. He's buried near Lake Placid, New York, where he had moved to live near a community where land had been given to free blacks to settle. Ralph Waldo Emerson clearly was among those who saw Brown as a martyr, writing in November of 1859, John Brown is that new saint than whom none purer or more brave was ever led by love of men into conflict and death, the new saint awaiting his martyrdom, and who, if he shall suffer, will make the gallows glorious like the cross. So using kind of Christian imagery there, talking about Brown. This was in a speech delivered in Boston on November the 8th, 1859 by Emerson, titled Courage. As Randy said, Abraham Lincoln, a little bit less effusive, stating in a speech that he thought Brown was insane. Hovenden had married into an abolitionist family whose Plymouth Meeting, Pennsylvania home was actually a stop on the Underground Railroad. It was known locally as Abolition Hall. And when nearly a quarter of a century after Brown's execution took place, Hovenden was commissioned by businessman Robbins Battelle of Norwalk, Connecticut, in New York City to depict the subject. He probably couldn't have picked an artist who would have done it more sympathetically because of these ties that he had through his wife's family to abolitionism. Brown is shown with his arms bound, a noose around his neck, on his way to the scaffold. Randy mentioned, and many scholars have noted, that his head recalls Michelangelo's Moses. And if you look very carefully, there's kind of a subtle cross formed behind him by the gun barrel and the belt of the man in gray who's standing behind him. Again, clearly equating Brown with Christ, a man willing to die to free those in society who were enslaved. On the morning of his execution, Brown wrote, "I, John Brown, am now quite certain that the crimes of this guilty land will never be purged away but with blood. I had, as I now think, vainly flattered myself that without very much bloodshed, it might be done." The detail of the African-American child being kissed by Brown may or may not have actually happened. There's a lot of debate about this. The detail comes from an article that appeared in the New York Tribune on December 5th that described Brown stopping to kiss an African-American child as he stepped out the door. It was then picked up by other newspapers. It inspired a poem. But later, the author of the article was kind of unclear about where that had come from and said he couldn't verify that that had happened. And many felt that it was probably unlikely that bystanders would have been allowed to get so close to such a high-profile prisoner. Whether fact or legend, that moment is really key to this painting by Hovenden. It really brings a humanity and a tenderness to it. And, you know, the meaning for this white artist was quite clear, that this was, you know, a white man who was willing to die to bring about a better future for African Americans. Hovenden himself, as an Irishman, had suffered greatly. You know, the English overlords had been cruel to the native Irish. He had left for America in 1863 during the famine. And so he really felt a particular sympathy in this country for those that were suffering and downtrodden. And as I mentioned, had married into a strong abolitionist family. He went on to become a teacher at the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts, where he actually replaced Thomas Aikens as a teacher when he was fired for his use of nude models in coeducational settings. And among the people who were Hovenden students at Pennsylvania Academy was the Ashcan school leader Robert Henry and the sculptor Alexander Calder. Hovenden died by being hit by a locomotive at a crossing near his home, in his prime of life. And his home and studio, which was his wife's property, his wife's family property, Abolition Hall, is now on the Register of National Historic Places. It's near the Friends, Plymouth Friends Meeting House in Pennsylvania. And Hovenden is buried in the churchyard there, which is very near where he lived. So a deep tie to abolitionism on the part of the artist's family. So I know we've run a few minutes over due to our technical glitches, but I'll end the slideshow. And I think Randy and I can stay around if we have some questions or discussion. You just need to turn on your microphone.
Nick, Jillian, this is Mary Cooper. Can you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead, Mary.
I had a question. I found it fascinating with the first painting and it being a female painting, and then we went all the way up to Mary Cassatt. So was there a period where women were just totally out of the picture, or are you suggesting by what you've shown that there was a subtle continuity of female artists?
Well, there's a wonderful article that if you haven't read it, I suggest you read, that was written in 1971 by Linda Nochlin under the title, Why Have There Been No Great Women Artists? Mm. And the early 1970s was the beginning of the feminist movement.
Right.
And, you know, Linda Nochlin was kind of raising the question, why don't we have any women artists appearing in any of the art history textbooks? We could ask the same question of artists of color as well. You know, it's a discipline that evolved in the 18th, early 19th century in Europe, mainly with German scholars. It's had a very Eurocentric history. The short answer is two things. One is that we certainly have had women painters working, you know, from the Renaissance on. Often those who did were members of artist families because they were able to get access to training, because most of the academies were, you know, limited. Women couldn't get access. But the other thing is that the way we valued particular art forms in the West, women traditionally have excelled at perhaps things like textile design, ceramic painting, things that when I was studying art history in the early 1970s and mid-1970s were considered minor arts when compared to painting or sculpture or architecture. The same thing when you look around the world. When I began to study African art, for example, those were the major art forms, things having to do with textile, wood carving, ceramics. So it really is how we have valued and taught and learned about art that's kind of built these biases into it. And, you know, we're having to do a lot of work to to change all that. Randy might want to weigh in on that for a minute, too.
Well, yeah, I mean, even if you think about this contemporary time, I mean, women artists are doing quite well currently. But when I was in school, there were these remarkable women artists. A lot of them had to teach because they were not able to sell works of art, but you have this strong body of work that's just beginning to become recognized currently. Faith Ringel is a perfect example of someone who was in school in New York, and she was told that she should not go into art because there are no women in art, and she should become an art educator. So she could become an art teacher, but not an artist. And so she taught in school for a number of years. Audrey Flack, someone that I've worked with for years, worked with all of the photorealists and never had the same type of recognition as most of her male counterparts until somewhat recently. And so it was, in many instances, a deliberate type of omission with this knowledge falsely put that women artists were not the equivalent of men artists. I am so fortunate because in my education, most of my models have been female artists, you know. But yeah, so I think that they have always been around. You know, and a lot of times too, a lot of women from very prominent homes were actually took lessons in art, but once married off, they were then, that went by the side. I remember I had a professor at NYU, Robert Capellas, and I went to visit him with another friend who was an artist, and she was a fine artist, and he was livid at her because she had gotten married, had kids, and he wanted to know if she was still working. And he just railed at the fact that this institution of marriage just destroys so many of our artists. I'll never forget that. But I think there are all sorts of reasons why. But I think these artists were always talented, always around, but never exposed, never had a chance to have exposure.
So any other questions? Go ahead.
Not necessarily a question, but I love Randy's suggestion about, you know, when going to, say, the Met. The Met, I think, has a tendency to over-curate some of their work, and they have these long explanations next to the painting or next to the art that by the time you finish reading it, you've hardly had a chance to look at it or look at it or get it, make your own thoughts about what the art is and everything. So
I tell my students, and I've said this for a lifetime, that, you know, I take you out to get ice cream, and I buy two ice cream cones, and I eat mine and I eat yours, and I tell you how yours tastes. And so often that's the aesthetic experience, is that we don't get it for ourselves. You know, and I am a firm believer that if you go to a museum and look at a work of art and don't give up on it, that you will get something from it. The artist didn't write the label. And as valuable as that information is, you want your experience to be about the work of art and then to be augmented by the experience of those who have greater knowledge about the work than we do. But that experience that you have in front of a work of art is so valuable. And I say this for a number of reasons. I mean, I didn't go to a museum until I was in college. And the first painting I ever looked at was a Jackson Pollock. And everybody in my class thought it was hideous, it was ugly, it wasn't a work of art. And the only thing that I could think about at that time was that this was exactly what I had experienced when I closed my eyes at night and my father was playing jazz. And later on, I found that, in fact, Jackson Pollock's image was used on a jazz record by a jazz artist. But I mean, and if I...
And he played it while listening to jazz.
No. But if someone had come in between that, I would not have had that experience.
And I think that the artists, you know, when they did the painting or the sculpture, they didn't have some curator in mind that was going to explain it to us. They did it for us to react to it and us to get something out of it. So Thank you for that, Randy.
Well, so much of art, especially historical art, was done as aesthetic literacy, and people could go into a church or a cathedral and they could read the paintings. I mean, they may not be able to read the Bible, but they could read those symbols. And a right. lot of that we have lost, but yeah.
So Randy, I knew I really loved you, but you mentioned Jackson Pollock. I wrote a term paper on him when I took art history before you, Jillian, with Dr. Lord. And and people said, why would you choose him? I just thought it was wonderful. But now when I look at a painting, I'm gonna think of your image. And I just wanted to add one comment about another comment on women as artists. You know, as young girls painted china. My grandmother took up oil painting in her 70s, and we are very proud of the fact that when she died in 1947, the New York Times wrote about how she was a well-known local artist. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, she could never have gone beyond that. But anyway, mm-hmm. this has been a wonderful program. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Well, it's been great to see so many of you, and we miss you. And,
yes, we do.
You know, hope we'll get to see some of you back, you know, on campus at some point in the flesh or at the Met at some point in the future. But, you know, it's wonderful, despite the few technical glitches getting going. You know, it's wonderful that we have this tool to connect, and we really appreciate your support of the college and your, you know, checking into this today, and, you know, your love of art. You know, artists are having a really rough time through this period.
Absolutely.
You know, galleries have been closed, museums have been closed, you know, getting financial support out of the government programs has been difficult. So, you know, those of you who love the arts, you know, just figure out ways to support the artists to get over the hump. And, you know, hopefully we'll all be back together again soon.
Are you, excuse me, first of all, thank you, Randy and Jillian, for this great afternoon. Are you going to be doing this again?
It's up to Jillian.
Our arms can be twisted.
when Jillian calls, I show up. She knows that.
Okay,
and I always thank Jillian, because I mean, I learned so much from Jillian. When I got her notes, I said, oh my goodness, when does she have time? You know, but I learned so much from Jillian. I really do. And I always thank her.
Well, I think it's a lot of fun to do this, because, you know, it really opens up all the various ways that you can appreciate art, respond to art. And, you know, there's not just one way. And I think in the end, as Randy said, you know, for it really to be meaningful, you know, you've got to connect on a personal level with the work of art. And, you know, that happens in different ways. So,
when museums open, I'll give you a really good museum exercise to do, something interesting to end with. When I'm at the museum, a lot of times people want to go to things that they're familiar with and things that they like. I always give an assignment where I ask my students to find a work of art that they don't like and stand in front of it for 15 minutes and simply to write about it. And more times than not, when people do that, they realize that they have more in common with the work than they realize. Because if we don't like it, we dismiss it and we don't spend time with it. And I often think, when you read a novel, you think about the amount of time that an artist, that a writer put into writing the novel. A work of art requires the same type of viewing in terms of the amount of time it was created. And that's why, for us, these things are old friends. I will go to the end of the world to see a Rembrandt. I could stand in front of a Rembrandt for hours. I have to be dragged away. But find something that, you know, that you think you don't like, and stand in front of it for a period of time and see what happens.
Like people.
Yeah, right. Like people.
Exactly.
Yeah. A metaphor for life.
Yes. Oh, so, I was going to use that. I mean, art is a metaphor for life.
So. Yes. Amen.
So, Jillian and Randy, this has been fabulous. I don't know if you've seen the comments in the chat, but I'll download them and send them to you. But I think everybody thanks you both for doing this. And I'll definitely take Stephen and Daisy's suggestion for doing this again. And I'll pester Jillian, who will pester Randy. So we'll take another view of four paintings and two perspectives, hopefully sometime soon. So thanks to everybody.
It was great. It was great to see everybody. Thank you so much.
It really this is quite wonderful.
Okay.
Be thank safe all of you. Everyone. Okay, you as well.
Thank you.
Be well.
Bye.